Hello and welcome to this presentation about network orchestration at ESNet. So first of all, I want to introduce us. So ESNet is basically the Department of Energy's internal wide area network provider. And we basically interconnect all US national laboratories, a few NNSA sites, and some other DOE facilities. To give you a few numbers, so ESNet is operating thousands of miles of fiber cables, including some transatlantic cables to our satellite sites in Europe. We have equipment in about 380 locations, and we operate roughly about 350 core links in our network. We do have 300 customer-facing interfaces, and 120 of them are supporting 100 gigabit. So ESNet is basically a multi-platform environment with lots of interoperability needs and challenges. So before we start, I want to briefly see and introduce orchestration. Orchestration is defined as the automated arrangement, coordination, and management of computer systems, middleware, and services within the network. That basically means it is a user-triggered workflow which implements a repeatable pattern of steps to automatically and programmatically provision configuration across the network. Why is orchestration important? So orchestration provides us with consistency and unified configurations. So this is actually a big one because back in the days, network engineers, everyone is kind of implementing policies or forwarding rules slightly different. So that leads to a lot of ununified configuration. And orchestration now gives us the opportunity to solve that with some sort of golden config so that all the configuration is looking the same. And that significantly enhances the network reliability, resilience, and also the robustness when it comes to the operation. It also allows us to manage a way larger network and eliminate human errors. So if someone is still a little bit sleepy or something and has a typo, that can take time to kind of determine and narrow down what was the actual problem during the configuration, and all these things are kind of like getting anticipated with automation and orchestration, which gives us also a better use of human resources. So network engineers can actually validate things, work on the design and architecture of the network instead of doing the boring part of the configuration. And it also gives us a lot of planning safety, so we can pretty much forecast how long a particular configuration will take, since it's deterministic, it's repeatable, and it's always the same. Now I briefly want to go into how actually our workflows are implemented. So our orchestration stack is basically composed out of three major components. So we have the energy equipment database, we have the workflow orchestrator, and we use Cisco NSO to talk to our network devices. So the first step is typically that the network planner, they kind of put the network design into ESDB. They do bulk data imports of links and all the data which was kind of connected during the wiring. In the next step, once we get a request, for instance, like to provision a customer interface or something like that, our engineers are going in and kind of plan out the service in ESDB. They further populate it with data. And then finally, they go into the orchestrator and just instantiate the service. And this is basically where our automation is kicking in. So once the workflow is getting triggered inside the orchestrator is fetching the service data from ESDB, It is applying the network intent and creates the corresponding NSO services, which then translate into network device configuration, which is getting pushed down to our network. And finally, it's updating the service data in the ESDB, for instance, the orchestrator subscription ID or things like that. So that was basically our orchestration in a nutshell. We want to look a little bit more into the Cisco Network Service Orchestrator and what we've built there. So the two main features ESNet is using are the device agnostic configuration NSO is providing, as well as the service centric abstraction. So the service centric abstraction gives us the opportunity to apply an intent straight to a service, which means like we want to create a backbone link. So instead of kind of configuring devices, we are now dealing with services. We create a backbone link service, which is pushing or manipulating configuration data on multiple devices in order to provision the service. And that we can do in a device agnostic way. So we are leveraging heterogeneous equipment in our network, and all this is abstracted out in NSO. So we don't care anymore what device is actually in the network. So the service and the implementation in NSO will take care of that. Other features which are really handy for us is the data verification and validation. So we can make sure in our NSO services that certain data which is getting added to the service is correct, so that it has a VLAN out of a correct range or correct interface or correct naming according to a certain specification. And another big one for us is the service decommissioning and rollbacks in NSO. So in case something is broken, we can immediately roll back to the prior working configuration. And also if we decommission services, NSO is very good in keeping track with reference counters on which configuration it puts into place. So once we roll back services, we are ending up with a clean state, basically exactly where we started. Here are a few more numbers too regarding our NSO services. We implemented around 33 service models, and as you can see down here, I have a few numbers for some of the instantiated services. So you can see that, for instance, the layer 3 customers with 277, that basically reflects the number I was mentioning in the beginning. We have bridge services, we have backbone link services, port services, and all that. Which kind of brings me to the conclusion here. We have, as many people, implemented a multi-tier service design in NSO, and we are kind of like moving towards a direction where we more see our entire orchestration stack as the service provider here, which means we are moving more and more services, at the higher layer services, we call them umbrella services, out of NSO into the workflow orchestrator in order to kind of simplify the overall services in NSO and make them easier testable. We are still working on this refactoring, and also one of the things we are trying to address at the moment is that we previously implemented monolithic services are getting more transitioned and broken down into this more granular multi-tier service architecture. And that was already it. And thank you for listening, and please enjoy the demo. So in this little demo, I want to show you how to enroll two core routers deploy a system service to them and connect them with the backbone link. Therefore, we will use our network orchestration stack, which is composed out of our energy sciences equipment database, the workflow orchestrator, which is a customized open source tool, and Cisco Ansel. So first things first, let's go into our equipment database. So in here, we have the equipment tab, and as you can see, there's already a lot of devices pre-populated. And what we want to do is we want to connect the core router in location 1 with the core router in location 2. So let's enroll them first. Therefore, we go into our workflow orchestrator and start a new process. We select enroll a core router and click next. Now we select a node, so we are getting a pre-selection of devices, of core routers from ESDB. So we select the first one and say submit. Now, with the workflow orchestrator, it's going through a predefined list of steps. So it's basically fetching the database information from ESDB. It is creating the orchestrator subscription model and generating some basic NSO payload, which it's pushing down via REST. So the device name, the device role, the orchestrator ID, and things like that. Okay. So this was successful. Let's do the same thing for the second core router in location 2. So we repeat the step, say enroll core router, next. So now we get the list again, but the router in location 1 is off the menu since we already enrolled that one. So submit, and it's going through the same workflow and enrolling the second. Okay, here we can see both enrollments were successfully created. We can cross-check that and go back into our equipment database. And when we update, when we reload the page, we can see that the orchestrator added an orchestration ID to the first and the second router. Okay, so the next step would be to add a system service, because we'll need that to create the backbone link. So let's select the first router here and the subscription of the first one, and then go to the action panel. So here we can see we can do a few things. We can terminate the subscription, we can modify it, and we can add a system service in order to prepare it for a backbone link, what we want to do. So I will confirm that. So now it's going through the system service deployment workflow, which is asking for a confirmation for the dry run. So now it's kind of like pushing all this information, like the service creation down to NSO, and giving us the dry run results here. This is a pretty long one, so we won't go over that. We'll just confirm it. Say submit. Okay, so it's done. So we are going back, and as we can see, we have successfully provisioned a system service to the first one. So we can also cross-check that. Let's go into the So let's go into the service manager here, and let's check for system service. So these are all our models. Service models, and we want to check for system service. And as you can see, we've created successfully a system service for the first router. We can also do the same by checking the CLI. So let's go into the container. So, system. And you can see there is the system service we created. Okay, let's do the same thing for this, for the second router. So we select the subscription for the second router, go on the action panel, select system service. It is going through the workflow again. We have to confirm the dry run results. And that was it. Subscription in sync. Back. So successfully provisioned the second service. We can cross-check. Let's update this page. Okay, we got the system service for the second one. We can do another check here. So there's our second system service. Okay, now since we have the system services, we can add a backbone link. So what we want to do here is, let's take a look at the equipment and look at the interfaces. So as you can see, this interface, which is currently in planning, is connected with the router and location two. So we want to, deploy the backbone link, provision it to this particular interconnection. So let's do that. So we go in here, say no process, and this time we select ECMP group, which is kind of like the backbone link. So we say start now. It's asking for the circuit, so it's presenting us already with a pre-selection of connections, of circuits associated with our router. So we select that one, that's the one we want to provision, and we submit that. Same thing, it's going to a predefined list of work of steps. And here you can see the device configuration it's generating, as well as the service generation. So it's creating the backbone link and the required port services. So let's confirm that. Submit. Okay, so that was it. Sync. Let's go back here. So we have successfully created the backbone link. Here, let's take a look at the backbone link services, and there's our subscription. Same here. Let's take a look, and there it is. And if we go back into our equipment database, reload this page. Oops. Okay, let's go back into the interface. You can see there's our orchestrator subscription ID, and the circuit is now deployed. Let's change the status into deployment. Okay, that was it. Thanks for listening.